6 years ago, I decided to put coils on a printed circuit to build a tiny motor. The idea barely worked, but it was enough to push me into developing dozens of other prototypes. This got me learning a lot about this technology, but what does it take to design an even better motor? One that is more efficient, compact, and durable enough to handle over a billion spins. I didn't say it was going to be easy, but to understand how I solved this problem, we have to go back 3 years. You see, after marrying the girl of my dreams, I decided to study PCB stators on my honeymoon. I wanted to reduce the losses of my winding, so I was curious what other people were trying. Especially because when you search for it on Google, these linear shaped coils come up. But mine just looked like alien cropped circles. This paper specifically tested different coil shapes to reduce current losses and eddy current losses. Eddy currents are like the spider tingle for metal. As soon as they sense a change in magnetic field, they will form, slightly warming up the metal. So yeah, because these magnets are spinning at thousands of RPM, there will definitely be losses. But my PCB stator is coreless, which already minimized most of their losses. But the copper itself will still get affected, and that's what this paper is trying to do, reduce the length of the copper to minimize losses. So after getting back home, I opened Altium Designer and started designing a coil with parallel winding. But soon I realized that this was impossible given the small size of my motor, which I didn't want to make bigger because I wanted to keep the same size to compare the results. So I had no other option but to stick with concentric windings. In this paper's result, the concentric winding still offered one of the highest torques. It just also had the highest copper loss. So what will happen if we try to bring that down? I designed all these new samples using Altium Designer, and if you're interested, you can also check out their Altium 365 platform. The goal here was to minimize resistance, but it's not as simple as it sounds, because there are other things to consider, like speed,
that's going so fast,
temperature, current limits, inductance, and KV. In fact, by making the coil thicker and shorter, it was essentially behaving more like a resistor, as it was heating up and drawing more current when spinning the same rotor. The RPM did improve as the load increased, but the most efficient was the one with the most turns and largest area, creating the biggest inductance to reduce the peak currents. This is a huge win because it makes the motor a low power brushless. These types of motors, you cannot just give them power and they spin. The rotor is like a merry-go-round and my hand is their driver, trying to switch it at the perfect timing not to lose sync. Which is quite challenging to do at high RPMs because it also needs to sense the speed via the back EMF. But a few months ago I found this IC that has everything integrated into one chip, which is specifically intended for low power brushless motors. You can control its speed via a PWM signal with the option of reading back the RPM. This makes so much sense considering that the whole point of PCB motors is to have everything more compact. But this tiny circuit was still defining the outline of my board. I explored so many designs, but none of them looked nice or compact, mainly because of the mounting holes and the standard connector, which I kind of prioritized because I wanted to keep it breadboard friendly. So at one point, I just decided to take a wild card, add two extra layers and put the driver directly behind the stator. If your eddy spider tingles are screaming, I get it. But I just wanted to understand how big the losses were. And my first prototype was kind of terrible. So I went back to Altium Designer, and this time I tried to minimize the copper to the absolute limit by reducing the ground nets and also making the passive slightly smaller. I reordered the new samples from PCB Way, and this one was much better. This design also had mounting holes closest to the rotor, which improved the performance and sound. At first it just had two, but I found that these were not always supporting the motor that well, so going for a forearm design made more sense. Now there were still some couple of problems left to solve. The rotor is being held in place with a bolt, a washer and a nut. I started with both a plastic washer and a plastic nut to avoid the currents, but this was getting squashed, creating part-to-part variations and varying the RPM. So I ended up using stainless steel for all these components. The lock nut did increase the overall height of the motor, but it was the most secure option compared to the others I tested. Going for 4 magnets instead of 8 made the motor spin slightly faster. These magnets were connected to an iron ring that enhanced the magnetic field but weakened it from the other side. I did test fully iron rotors at multiple points throughout this project, but they were more expensive and more difficult to assemble. The next problem is related to the bearing's friction. Yep, bearings do still have friction. In fact, it had three different types. The first type is related to the type of balls it has inside. You probably know that steel ball bearings have to be oiled from time to time, but they are also magnetic, which is probably why I found they spin a little bit slower compared to ceramic ball bearings. These are non-metallic, so they are also corrosion resistant. And I tested multiple bearings from different manufacturers. Some stopped working after a few high RPM spins, and others had large part-to-part tolerance. So to get the right option, it had to be a pricey one, having the tightest tolerance and the highest quality. This rating also means that we can also use one bearing instead of two, further reducing the friction losses. In my older prototypes, one bearing got my motor too wobbly, but with this new bearing, the radial play was small, reducing the wobble to less than 0.4 mm. And this design choice also got the rotor super slim. This only leaves us with one problem left to solve, but I didn't know this problem even existed. It literally cost me months of testing, and I couldn't understand why it was happening. So here's when my engineering cousin came in to help me with this project. But before I explain what this problem was and how we solved it, let's just talk about the fact that the motor is shaftless. How am I supposed to connect parts to it without a shaft? My first approach was to add two threaded holes, but overall this added more weight to the rotor and also increased the price even further. So next, I started experimenting with 3D printed rotors.
Seems to be working very good with the 3D printed rotor.
These were much lighter and could directly be integrated into the parts themselves. But to keep the bearing secure in place, it had to be press fit and glued in place. Which is fine, but it couldn't handle the speed. The rotor was completely shattering and sometimes also cutting off the coils. Here's where my cousin suggested knurling. These are like tiny teeth on the side of the motor, which can be used to press and secure the parts into the rotor. A simple solution that is safer and doesn't add extra weight. However, it does require more precise aluminium parts. So after ordering a couple of samples, we pressed the bearing inside the rotor and started testing it. And after 1 month, everything was still spinning without any problems. So we ordered more rotors, started another test, and this time they started failing one by one within days. This was so devastating. Our first thought was that the pressing process was somehow damaging the bearings. We tried multiple things like customizing the jig further and cooling the bearings to have a smoother transition, but the problem just wasn't solved. Here's when we realized that this new batch of rotors slightly had a smaller diameter than the first one, which was still within tolerance but large enough to tighten the bearings, adding just enough friction to reduce their RPM limits and shorten their lifetime. It was an expensive mistake but a highly valuable educational one. We had to find a brand new supplier that had tighter tolerances and could more precisely press fit the bearings. So this time we increased the sample count and started a brand new test. While this was being tested, we also started measuring the dynamic torque and efficiency of the motor. This was done by using these 3D printed discs. As their mass increased, the speed obviously reduced. And I have to admit that these results were not very satisfying. But considering they're coming from a thin FR4 board, I adjusted my expectations and started exploring potential applications. Like a disc launcher. The grippy rotor teeth are spinning at 30,000 RPM, so they make an excellent flywheel. I'm curious about the speed, so let's measure it Spider-Man style. That seems to be going at 30 meters per second, which is insane. Some other applications I tested is this Fibonacci spinning guard, which created a super cool illusion. Next, I wanted to explore vibration. By adding an off-centered mass, we can convert the high RPM into vibrational energy. And this worked quite well. I could easily see this being implemented directly on the PCB to create haptic feedback. As I explained a few seconds ago, the torque of this motor is not that great, so it struggled to spin large propellers. I tried to test different propeller designs, but this model gave the best results. But from testing other micro drone motors, it is clear that to make a PCB drone work, we either need to push more current or increase the voltage. So I will definitely explore that with a new motor in the future. This might make the performance of this motor seem weak, but drag is really affecting the torque here. For example, by keeping the mass at the smallest radius, it managed to spin a small 3D printed steerer and also power this tiny two-wheeled robot. Honestly, this tiny robot is what motivates us to make this motor, but it's very weight dependent and hard to control, which limits its applications. It struggles the most to start up and sync the motors. I will probably talk more about it in the future, but for now let's see if the motors pass the durability test. Okay, so it's been a whole month and it seems that every motor is still spinning. I'm going to stop the test here. And we're going to start checking them one by one. None of the stators had any scratches and the speed also remained constant during the test. On average, each motor was spinning at 37,000 RPM, so we tested a bit higher than the 30,000 RPM limit, but this means that each motor made more than 1.6 billion spins. So we're finally confident to actually sell this on microbots.io. I have to be totally honest and admit that its price is a bit on the high side. We wished its price would be cheaper, but considering how much R&D this project involved, we're barely making any money from it. Besides that, when you compare its price to other micro brushless motors, it falls on the cheap end, considering the fact that it has an onboard driver. In the end, it doesn't really matter that much because we're just curious what type of applications we can use with it. Now, I think PCB motors is a very new technology, which only a few number of people has ever worked on. So by having this motor, it makes it available for students, makers, and engineers to test out this technology, especially because the stator is open source. So you can directly put this motor on to your own custom PCB, and I think that makes it much more useful. If you learned something from this video, please hit the like button and consider subscribing if you haven't yet. Huge thank you to all my Patreons for supporting this project.